Dr. Blackwell, having finished your time in Europe and in England, you then made a decision to come back to the United States and to practice in New York City, one of the more competitive areas for a doctor to decide to practice. Tell me about your experience there.
Those early years were very difficult. First, finding a place to practice was hard because people did not want to rent to a woman physician. They weren't used to women physicians. They thought women might just be abortionists. And I finally found a place near Washington Square, New York. But my practice was never very busy in the beginning, so I needed to do something else. And so I applied to the dispensaries in New York City and was turned down by the dispensaries with the suggestion that, why don't I start my own? So I decided I would do that. And I started my own by going to the tenement areas in Lower East Side of New York, where people lived in squalid, poorly hygienic conditions, and the women really needed help for themselves and for their children. And so that's what I did. But I didn't do it alone. I got a board of some prominent physicians and other leaders in New York to help me. And then it became successful.
And in bringing in help, you brought in a number of women who either were physicians or you saw to it had the training to become physicians.
Yes, two of them really stand out. The first two stand out as people that I helped guide them through medical school. One was Maria Zakharuska, who was a midwife from Europe, and she was very bright, and so I suggested she go to medical school, and she eventually did, and then joined us. And the other was my sister Emily, and Emily couldn't get into my medical school because they had then decided they weren't taking women, but she went to medical school and then also trained in Europe. And then lastly, I hired Rebecca Cole. Rebecca Cole had been to medical school in the United States. She was, I think, the second African-American woman in the United States to go to medical school. And she worked right in the tenements of New York, visiting the homes and taking care of the women and providing some education of how to best care for yourself and your children and your family.
And your practice, I think, rolled your knowledge and experience with Florence Nightingale into it. So you brought to the practice of medicine a sense of the importance of hygiene and prevention.
Well, it was pretty obvious then that the social conditions made a big impact on people's health, and what Florence Nightingale had done demonstrated that, and mm-hmm. So we brought that to New York.
And as the practice grew with the dispensary and services expanded, you also opened an infirmary, what would later become known as a hospital.
Right, the New York Infirmary for Women and Children had some beds so people could have a hospital. The advantage of that is that not only did it care for the women in New York, women who wouldn't have had an option, but it offered women physicians, because now there was a growing number of women physicians, a place to practice because they often couldn't get privileges at hospitals. Mm-hmm. And eventually it would offer medical students an opportunity to study medicine in a hospital that belonged to a medical school, and they would be taught by women faculty members.
And this brings us to the fact that at this time, traditional medical schools were now admitting women.
Yes, they were.
But there also were concerns that you had regarding the quality of education they were receiving.
Well, there were about 17 medical schools for women eventually opened. I went to visit some of the earlier ones, and many of them were proprietary schools. And that meant they were for-profit, they were short, and the women were not getting an adequate education. So the only way to resolve that, now there were some good women medical schools, I don't mean to think that there weren't. Philadelphia was particularly outstanding, but I visited some of them and realized that the women, what I felt, were being shortchanged. And I knew that they were going to have difficulty in the profession just because of their gender, but I didn't want them to have difficulty also because they were poorly trained. So we started our own medical school.
Right. And your medical school differed from the traditional medical school of the time. And how was that?
Well, first place, it had very high admission standards. It had a longer curriculum. And it had a hospital. So it had all the elements of what a good medical school should have.
And what would come to take for granted at a later time. So this was at a time when one did not even need a high school diploma to go to medical school. Medical schools would teach a course at a time and provide a certificate for each course. And there was little or no exposure to sick patients for medical students. So you recognized these deficiencies and raised the bar.
Yes, well, you know, some of those medical schools were two-year schools and they taught the same thing the second year. You just had to do better on the second year than you did in the first year.
Mm-hmm.
That didn't make a lot of sense to me. Mm-hmm. So we did start.
And so you required pre-medical education, you expanded the curriculum to 3 years, and you combined the education with exposure to the patients in the hospital.
That's exactly right. Yes.
Excellent.